Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Write It Down, Make It Happen: Knowing What You Want and Getting It by Henriette Anne Klauser. Narrated by Mike Chamberlain. I worked for a menial's hire, only to learn, dismayed, that any wage I had asked of life, life would have willingly paid. Anonymous poet, quoted by Napoleon Hill in Think and Grow Rich. Introduction. An Egyptian scribe sits on my fireplace hearth. The stone statue is a replica brought back from my trip to Cairo several years ago. He sits cross-legged, a papyrus scroll across his lap, and a stylus poised in his hand, ready to write. His eyes are wise and far away, as though he could see the future. He is a symbol of what this book is all about. For the ancient people of the Nile, writing something made it real. Think big. It works. In the 1920s and 30s, a host of titles appeared, exclaiming, sometimes literally, "Victory, success, you can do it. The wonders of the science of thought." Napoleon Hill's Think and Grow Rich, Claude M. Bristol's The Magic of Believing, James Allen's As a Man Thinketh, and then, in the 50s, David J. Schwartz's The Magic of Thinking Big. Remarkably, all of these books are still in print and readily available at the bookstore now, 50, 60, even 70 years later. As archaic the language, quaint the examples, and blatant the sexism seem today, these books still hit a resonant chord with a modern audience. One small pamphlet, written in 1926 and still circulating over 1.5 million copies later, is simply called It Works by R.H.J. This tiny tome sums up the staying power of these proponents of proactive, positive thinking. More than just a glossed over, Pollyannish, witless approach, they have an important message, which It Works puts succinctly in its opening epigram. If you know what you want, you can have it. All our years of brain research, all our current knowledge about the corpus callosum, the reticular activating system, and the workings of the human mind, and we are still left with an aw shucks, golly gee sense of wonder that it works. Write It Down, Make It Happen keeps that sense of wonder and is grounded in the same now scientific truth that setting your intent, focusing on the outcome, being clear about what you want in life can make your dreams come true. There is another key element that comes into play, an element that each and every one of these long-lasting books has in common. The first step in all of them is to write down your goal. Celebrity stories. I keep hearing wonderful stories about celebrities who, before they were famous as they are today, wrote down their dreams. Jim Carrey walked up to the Hollywood Hills and wrote a check to himself for $10 million. On the memo line, he wrote, "For services rendered." For years, the comedian carried the check around with him, long before he was ever paid that kind of money for a movie. Now he is one of the highest-paid entertainers in the industry, getting $20 million for a film. In a touching gesture, Carrey tucked the visionary check into his dad's jacket pocket before they buried him. Scott Adams, creator of the comic Dilbert, has a whole string of writing down dreams that came true, one step at a time. Adams says that when you write down a goal, you'll observe things happening that will make that objective more likely to materialize. As a lowly technology worker in a cubicle in corporate America, Adams kept doodling at his office desk. Then he began to write, 15 times a day, "I will become a syndicated cartoonist." Through many rejections, he persevered, and finally it happened. He signed a contract for his strip to be syndicated. That's when he started writing, "I will be the best cartoonist on the planet." How to judge that? Well, Dilbert is syndicated in almost 2,000 newspapers worldwide. The Dilbert Zone website gets 100,000 visitors a day. Adams' first book, The Dilbert Principle, sold more than 1.3 million copies. Products from mouse pads to coffee cups to desk calendars based on the Dilbert characters are everywhere, and there is even a weekly TV show. Now Scott Adams writes 15 times a day, "I will win a Pulitzer Prize." Susie Orman, financial wizard, author of the number one New York Times bestseller, The 9 Steps to Financial Freedom, and a frequent guest on Oprah, tells how she started out. She got a job at Merrill Lynch and was terrified she would not be able to meet her sales quota. The most she had ever made up until then was $400 a month as a waitress. "I created what I wanted for myself first on paper. Every morning before I went to work, I would write over and over again, 'I am young, powerful, and successful, producing at least $10,000 a month.'" Even after surpassing that target figure, she continued to carry the saying around with her like a lucky charm in words. "I replaced the message of fear and my belief I was inadequate with a message of endless possibility." And writing down her new truth helped make it materialize. My own inspiration for this book came from closer to home. My son Peter, at the age of 12, came to me one day with a perplexed expression and a piece of paper in his hand. "I found this list from 2 years ago when I was cleaning my room. I don't know how, but everything on this list came true, and I forgot I wrote it." Among other things, he had taken karate lessons, tried out for a play, slept overnight at the park, and gotten a bird, all without being conscious of checking off items on the forgotten list. Peter's experience made me think. I noticed the same phenomenon happening in my own life. In one exciting and memorable week of my life, I managed to autograph books on Broadway in New York City, go backstage at the Metropolitan Opera, be interviewed on the radio for an audience of several million, and hear Placido Domingo live in a full-length opera. It wasn't until I got back to the West Coast that I found, like Peter before me, an old goals list I had forgotten about. All of the things I had just accomplished were on that list. I tell the story of Peter's list and my list in a chapter of my book, Put Your Heart on Paper. Another chapter in that book, The Shoeless Joe Principle, treats synchronicity, or what seems like coincidence, quoting the line from Field of Dreams, "If you build it, he will come." Building it before he gets there is stepping out in faith, just as writing it down says you believe that it's attainable. Those two chapters were the beginning of my investigation into the power of writing things down to make them happen, and the genesis of this book. Who am I to tell you this? Let me tell you a bit about my background. I have a PhD in English literature and have taught in universities in New York, Los Angeles, Seattle, and Lethbridge, Canada, in Alberta. My first book, Writing on Both Sides of the Brain, addresses the problems of procrastination and deals with writing anxiety. It is about learning to separate the writing from the editing. It teaches you first to write, then to polish your words, rather than trying to do both at the same time. Writing on Both Sides of the Brain describes how to interview the critic, that inner carping voice that can hold you back, and introduces the concept of rapid writing, writing fast, lickety-split, past the critic. For the past 15 years, I've been giving workshops for corporations around the country and presentations at national associations. It was out of that work that my second book, Put Your Heart on Paper, evolved. Once people grasped and used the concepts of fluent writing I taught them, they would often say to me, "This isn't about writing, it's about life." Put Your Heart on Paper applies the freedom to write to relationships and shows how to stay connected in this loose ends world. Two of the concepts in that work that I explore further here are writing through to resolution in Chapter 6 and how to let writing help you think in Chapter 2. Where do these stories come from? Once I decided to write this book, the stories to go in it seemed to seek me out in much the same manner that readers of this book will find the world cooperating with them. How could it not be so? A book about adventures happening has to be an adventure happening. Stories came up and tapped me on the shoulder. Every phone call was loaded. 9 of the people whose stories I tell here, I did not even know when I proposed the idea to the publisher. One of those people was the best-selling writer Elaine St. James. It was she who called me on the recommendation of a mutual friend about something else. The interview I had with her blew my socks off. I was so wound up after talking to her, I could hardly sit still. What was it that turned me on and spun me around and around? First, it was Elaine herself, a high-energy person. She made giant leaps sound so possible, so near and accessible, and she was funny. Further, in talking to her, I had a clear vision that her story would be an important piece in Write It Down, Make It Happen. Not one, but 2 chapters came from that conversation. As I put those chapters together, I realized with a start that they weren't there a week ago. That's the part that thrilled me most, how readily what I needed was available to me. The work fleshed itself out even as I wrote it. Write It Down, Make It Happen was written almost entirely in the coffee houses of Seattle. Several of the stories come right out of this penchant I have for writing in medias res. For example, the story of Jamie's demo tape in Chapter 20 and Maria's dream apartment in Chapter 8. When you write in an espresso place, life keeps happening all around you. And then, of course, I followed my own dictum and simply wrote it down when I needed a good story. For example, as I was gathering together the anecdotes to illustrate the principles of this book, I noticed something was missing. I wanted to show that my techniques could work wherever in the world you were. One morning I wrote, "I need a rural story from Middle America. I want my readers to know that these techniques work for everyone, whether you live in a big city or a small town." 2 days later, my office phone rang. A woman named Marion was calling from Wells, Nevada, population 1,000. She had read my other books and wanted to know if I ever came to Nevada to do workshops. We got to talking, and soon she was telling me a remarkable narrative about an impossible dream come true. And wouldn't you know, she wrote it down before it happened. Marion's touching tale became the impetus for Chapter 14, Taking the Initiative. How to approach this book. Some people keep journals. Some jot down ideas on napkins, the backs of envelopes, pages torn from a legal pad, or any scrap of paper near at hand. Do not fret about the kind of paper to use to write it down, or worry whether it should be bound in a notebook or loose on stationery. Any kind of paper, lined or unlined, quality or coarse, in a notebook or out of it, and any kind of pen or pencil with any color ink will do. My only rule is date whatever you write down. You can wear whatever you choose. There is no dress code. Maybe you are beginning to get the general idea. This is not a contest where you are disqualified unless you print legibly, follow the rules, write on a 3x5 card, and remember to include the box top. You can write it down any way you want and still have results. Jim Carrey wrote it once and put it in his pocket. Scott Adams and Susie Orman wrote it over and over daily. My son Peter wrote it and lost it. My point is that anybody can do this, and there is no right way or wrong way, because everyone does it differently, and it still works. It's a matter of faith. I saw a bumper sticker with a catchy slogan on a car in the church parking lot. I copied it onto the back of the Sunday bulletin so I'd remember it. It said, "Good happens." It made me smile to see that sign. "Good happens" is the philosophy behind this book. My premise is the overriding belief that good things happen and that life is a narrative you have a hand in writing. We get so hung up on format, but it's the faith that matters, the faith that good happens. Have you heard of the practice of burying a statue of St. Joseph head first in your yard when you want to sell your house quickly? Many people I know swear by it, and such lofty forums as the New York Times and Time magazine have done articles describing the pious practice. When I was preparing to sell my house, I hated the thought of keeping it in showroom condition, down to monitoring flossing flecks on the bathroom mirrors. I cringed at the idea of strangers traipsing through my personal rooms. Somewhat sheepishly, I went to the local Catholic gift shop, for heaven's sake, to buy a statue of St. Joseph. When I told Agnes, the proprietor, what I wanted, she added an element I had not heard of up until then. Agnes said that you need to put a marker where you plant St. Joseph, so after the house sells, you can dig him up and put him in a place of honor in your new home. I started to ask Agnes all kinds of questions. I was worried about doing it right. Did the statue have to be an expensive one, carved of wood and hand-painted? Or would a cheaper small model, a molded plastic figurine, work as well? Which way did I face him, toward the house or the street? Do I plant him in the backyard or the front? Would the sandbox be okay? Frankly, I didn't have the heart to bury him. Would it still work if I protected him by wrapping him in saran wrap or putting him in a Ziploc bag? It seemed so crude to cover him in dirt. Or was that earthy contact part of what was needed here? Did I have to get the statue blessed before or after, or not at all? Agnes said, "Look, you don't have to bury him at all if you don't want. Saint Joseph is the patron saint of families and of homes. If you ask for his help, he will be there for you. It's not the burying that does it. It's the prayer to Saint Joseph and the confidence that he will help you." I liked what Agnes was telling me. I put a small polymer statue of Saint Joseph on a glass shelf on the étagère as you enter the house, next to a triptych of the Madonna and a statue of the goddess Guan Yin that has been in my family for 3 generations. On a shelf below sat a little replica of Selket, who guarded King Tut's tomb. Open house was scheduled for Sunday. In preparation, the realtor hammered a for sale sign into the lawn. The lockbox was to go on, and early viewing to begin on Thursday. I dreaded it. I knew what I wanted, as impossible as it seemed. I wanted my house to sell quickly, without going on the market. It was Wednesday morning when I put St. Joseph on the étagère, and then left to take my daughter Catherine to the orthodontist. While in the dentist's waiting room, I described in writing my perfect scenario. I wrote it as though it had already happened. A woman in the neighborhood, a complete stranger to me, found out that I was planning to put my house on the market. Wednesday afternoon, she came by with her husband and bought the house for over the listing price, and I never had to show it at all. I wrote those exact words in my big brown national notebook on Wednesday morning. Wednesday night, it happened precisely as I pictured it, with a nifty difference. While the woman was viewing the house, 2 other couples drove by and asked to take a look around. Within the hour, all 3 parties had drawn up papers, returned with their realtors, and made offers on the house above the asking price. The small, cream-colored St. Joseph sat in a place of honor on the kitchen table as we negotiated the various contracts and chose the best buyer. By midnight Wednesday, I had sold my house, and I never had to show it at all. There is no right way or wrong way to do it. Life is a narrative that you have a hand in writing. Let's begin. List of questions. Here are some thoughts that might be running through your head. I hate to write. How is this kind of writing different? I don't know what I want. What if? What if? What if? What if I don't get what I want? What if I do? I'm scared. How do I know the difference between wanting something and being ready to receive it? Is there more than one way to get a certain goal? How do I know when I am on the right track? Can I have more than one goal at a time? What do I do when I am stuck? Does it matter how specific I am? How do I keep the dream alive? Does the support of others help, or should I keep it to myself? What is the difference between fantasy and imagination in goal setting? Why am I afraid to dream big, to ask for what I want? What if I write it down and it does not happen? What do I need to do to complete the cycle? The chapters that follow answer these concerns and tell the stories of people who have put the book's principles to good use, each in his or her own unique way. They are extraordinary, ordinary people, just like you. The people in these pages have told their stories not so you'll think they are wonderful, but so you know that you are. By the time you have finished listening to this book and doing the exercises, you will know how to write it down and make it happen in your own life. 1. Write it down, make it happen. Without further ado, before you listen to the chapters which follow, I want you to compose your own list of goals. Go to an espresso bar and buy a latte, or put on a pot of peppermint tea at your own house. Set the stereo for the kind of music you like best and start to write. Write fast. Do not linger over the page. If you find yourself dismissing a goal as grandiose or far-fetched, write it anyway and put a star next to it. That's a live one. Do not be afraid of wanting too much. Write down even those ambitions which have no practical means of accomplishment. Keep on writing. Write from your heart and make the list as long as you like. Lou Holtz, the famous football coach, did this in 1966. He was 28 years old when he sat down at his dining room table and wrote out 107 impossible goals. He had just lost his job. He had no money in the bank. And his wife, Beth, was 8 months pregnant with their third child. He was so discouraged that Beth gave him a copy of The Magic of Thinking Big by David J. Schwartz to help lift his spirits. Up until then, Holtz says, he was totally lacking in motivation. There are so many people, and I was one of them, who don't do anything special with their lives. The book said you should write down all the goals you wanted to achieve before you died. The goals he wrote in answer to that challenge were both personal and professional. Most seemed impossible to a 28-year-old out-of-work man. His list included having dinner at the White House, appearing on The Tonight Show, meeting the Pope, becoming head coach at Notre Dame, winning a national championship, being coach of the year, landing on an aircraft carrier, making a hole-in-one, and jumping out of an airplane. If you check out Coach Lou Holtz's website, along with this list, you will get pictures. Pictures of Holtz with the Pope, with President Ronald Reagan at the White House, yucking it up with Johnny Carson. In addition, a description of what it was like to jump out of an airplane and get not one, but two holes in one. Of the 107 goals on his list from 1966, Lou Holtz has achieved 81. So give yourself permission to dream, to be totally unrealistic. Richard Bowles says, one of the saddest lines in the world is, "Oh, come now, be realistic." Climb Mount Kilimanjaro. Endow a university or a hospital. Compose an opera. Start an orphanage. Become a better parent. Play the flute in Carnegie Hall. Discover a cure for an untreatable disease. Get a patent. Appear on TV, or whatever equivalent grandiose schemes you can come up with, if money were no object and time were not a factor. Money is no object, and time is not a factor. Make it happen, watching for signs and signals. Once you write a goal in good faith, how do you know you are on the right path? Signs are all around you, sometimes literally. My daughter Emily, running around Green Lake, spotted a young lad of about 14 rollerblading with a sandwich board attached to his back and front. Free queen-size bed. Follow me. Turns out his grandmother was moving and giving away a queen-size bed with mattress, headboard, springs, and a vanity to boot. Perfect for Emily's friend who was looking for ways to furnish her new student apartment. Emily lives her life in constant expectation of good things happening. And so they do. Emily knows that assistance is there for her whenever she needs it. Once, She was laboring over choosing a term paper theme at the downtown library when a voice, as though from heaven, shattered the library silence. "All students needing help with homework, please come to the second floor." She was the only student who answered the call, and had the head librarian all to herself in a conference room for exclusive and rewarding tutoring on her topic. I have often wished that when we are struggling with a decision or dilemma, that the clouds would part, and a cosmic Charlton Heston-type voice would invite us to the second floor, where the librarian of life would sit with us for several hours, patiently answering all our questions and giving direction. "All those needing help with life, please come to the second floor." Fact is, there is that kind of direct and personal guidance available, but often we don't hear or see it. Or, if we get the message at all, we dismiss it as accidental, which diminishes its personal nature. We think of such occurrences as coincidences, isolated events that are easily chalked up to luck or happenstance. I prefer to call them go incidences. A go incidence is part of a pattern. Such events are a sign, a signal. Go incidences carry the forward motion of a green light, the final syllable urgency of a referee at the track. On your mark, get set, go! C.G. Jung called it synchronicity, when events coincide in a serendipitous way. Some call it messages from the universe or cosmic connections. It is the sense that you are not alone, and that your life, no matter how it may seem at any particular disastrous moment, is part of a larger plan. Some believe that we send out energy waves, transmissions, vibrations, whatever, that attract people, solutions to us. Others call it divine intervention. These views are not mutually exclusive. I, for one, hold a little bit of each of them. What these views have in common is a duality that, one, puts us in charge, while, two, also implying a higher power who is guiding, watching out, caring about each and every one of us. Writing it down sends a notice to the universe, "Hey, I'm ready." And go incidences are signs that send a message back, "I got your signal and I'm working on it." Help from your brain. Writing down your dreams and aspirations is like hanging up a sign that says, "Open for business." Or, as my friend Elaine puts it, by writing it down, you declare yourself in the game. Putting it on paper alerts the part of your brain known as the reticular activating system to join you in the play. At the base of the brainstem, about the size of a little finger, is a group of cells whose job it is to sort and evaluate incoming data. This control center is known as the reticular activating system, RAS. The RAS sends the urgent stuff to the active part of your brain and sends the non-urgent to the subconscious. The RAS awakens the brain to consciousness and keeps it alert, just as surely as your baby's cry in the night from all the way down the hall can waken you from a deep sleep. The RAS evaluates the non-essential nighttime noises, the dripping faucet, the crickets, or neighborhood traffic, and filters out the non-urgent, waking you up only for the urgent. The baby cries, and in a split second you are bolt upright in bed, wide awake and ready to rescue the infant in distress. The keenest, most familiar example of the reticular activating system at work is an experience all of us have had at one time or another. You are in a packed room. You can barely hear the conversation of the person you are talking to above the din of the crowd. Suddenly, someone clear on the other side of the room mentions your name, and that one word cuts through the sea of sound and your ears immediately perk up. You turn your head toward the speaker, eager now to tune in the rest of what he or she is saying about you, straining to hear if it is good news, ready to defend the bad. That is a prime example of your monitoring mechanism, your reticular activating system, at work. You have just tuned in to something specific and useful to you. Although you may think you are giving your conversational companion undivided attention, the fact is your attention is fragmented and subconsciously taking in the Tower of Babel around you, sorting, 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 even as you speak. Your name, when spoken, stands out as prominently as a speck of gold in a miner's pan of gravel. The RAS is like a filtering system of the brain. Writing it down sets up the filter. Things start to appear. It's a matter of your filtering system. If you have never owned a Honda before, and you buy a blue Honda, all of a sudden you see blue Hondas all over town. You might wonder, where are all these blue Hondas coming from? But they were there all along. You were just not paying attention to them. Putting a goal in writing is like buying a blue Honda. It sets up a filter that helps you be aware of certain things in your surroundings. Writing triggers the RAS, which in turn sends a signal to the cerebral cortex, wake up, pay attention, don't miss this detail. Once you write down a goal, your brain will be working overtime to see you get it, and will alert you to the signs and signals that, like the blue Honda, were there all along. Polishing coconuts. Often a goal, once written, will materialize without any further effort on your part. But it doesn't hurt either to prime the pump. The more attractive you make whatever your ambition, and the more you approach it in the spirit of fun, the more others will want to play along to make your dream a reality. I call this playful spreading of the word polishing coconuts. Scientists in the 60s were monitoring monkeys on a remote Japanese island who were cleaning sand off sweet potatoes by washing them in a stream. When the critical mass of monkeys doing this activity reached a certain number, primates on another island began doing the same thing. Ken Keyes Jr. took this experiment as a metaphor for an individual's personal responsibility to think peace. You never know if you might be the 100th monkey exploding the common consciousness into mass understanding. I use the expression polishing coconuts, somehow it is more catchy than getting sand off yams, to mean how activity in one area generates movement in another. When you show your earnestness and intention by writing it down, something opens up. The word gets out. My sons, James and Peter, own and operate a graphic design firm. They are imaginative, creative, and indefatigable workers, and their business is thriving. At the beginning of each month, they have a planning session where they write down their goals for the month. Then, every Monday morning, they select and write on a dry erase board the goals for the week. From that point on, they know that their activities, often indirectly, will feed those goals. What delights them, constantly, is the amount of work they get from untapped sources. Peter and James are gleeful when they talk about the success they have polishing coconuts. When they are wooing one account, and another opens up from an unexpected place. Peter gives an example. We wanted to generate more business for Bullseye Graphics, so we put together a newsletter and sent it out to our existing clients. Almost immediately, we started getting phone calls. But interestingly enough, the phone calls weren't from clients, they were from people not on our mailing list. We were putting the energy out there, and the phone started ringing from new contacts. They wrote down the goal. We want more exposure to get our name before the public. They set up a booth at a trade show. They sent notices out to area companies who might need design help. They approached new businesses with an introductory offer, giving them a deal on an identity package. Many of these efforts and expenditures did not pan out directly.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.